Buenos días a todos y bienvenidos a esta primera sesión de esta nueva iniciativa que lanzamos conjuntamente hoy entre el Real Instituto Elcano y la Fundación Naturgy, que pretende crear un marco de reflexión sobre las sendas geopolíticas de la transición energética, focalizándonos en cada una de las sesiones en un área concreta del planeta, en este caso Oriente Medio. Para esta primera sesión, que celebramos de manera híbrida con presencia física aquí en el auditorio y con más de 600 personas registradas para su seguimiento online, tenemos la fortuna de contar para la apertura con José Juan Díaz, presidente del Real Instituto Elcano, y Francisco Reinés, presidente de Naturgy, a quien cedo ya la palabra para la apertura de la jornada.
Gracias, Manuel, y buenos días a todos los que estáis hoy aquí en Avenida de América y todos los que estáis conectados, ¿no? Yo creo que en este tipo de sesiones que hoy inauguramos, pues Naturgy pone el tank y el Instituto Elcano por el zinc, ¿no? Y yo creo que esto es lo bueno, porque lo que necesitamos es, como decíamos ahora antes de la apertura, necesitamos zinc y necesitamos datos y necesitamos gente que nos pueda ayudar a pensar y tener opiniones fundadas y menos opiniones basadas en otras opiniones, ¿no? El mundo hoy está lleno de opiniones más o menos gratuitas y si nos centramos en el tema de la energía, desgraciadamente un tema que a veces es arduo y que no es muy atractivo para muchos, pero sí que se necesitan tener algunas cosas claras. Total. Y dentro de esto pues esperamos que este tipo de encuentros sirvan para ello. Lo primero que tengo que hacer es dar las gracias y sentirnos honrados como Fundación Naturgy de tener al Instituto Elcano como partner en estas charlas que hoy comienzan, ¿no? Yo creo que el prestigio del Instituto Elcano es suficientemente conocido por todos y le incorpora a estos diálogos la seriedad y el rigor que se requiere para poder obtener una serie de ideas y una serie de opiniones que estén fundadas, ¿no? El motivo del encuentro y el título del encuentro no puede ser de mayor actualidad. Esto de la transición energética, yo creo que en general, si solamente hubiéramos dicho que íbamos a hablar de energía, ya era de actualidad, porque la energía pues probablemente está hoy en boca de todos por muchos acontecimientos geopolíticos, estratégicos y económicos, pero si encima lo unimos al concepto transición, pues aún mucho más, ¿no? Yo creo que nadie hoy cuestiona la necesidad de abordar el problema. Lo vivimos hoy. Basta salir fuera de este edificio y ver que estamos 6 grados por encima de los que deberíamos estar en un día de mayo como estamos, ¿no? Por lo tanto, que evidentemente hay que afrontar el problema del cambio climático es evidente, que lo tiene que afrontar la sociedad en su conjunto también y que desde aquí pues la Fundación Naturgy apuesta por ayudar a cómo enfrentarlo desde la perspectiva de la energía, que son uno de los múltiples actores que hay y que pueden hacer algo para mejorarlo, pues también, ¿no? Yo creo que del cambio climático se puede hablar poco porque ya se ha hablado mucho, pero quizás lo que sí como Naturgy querría decir volver a insistir, que ya lo intento hacer todas las veces que tengo ocasión, es que la forma de afrontarlo debe ser un poco un traje a medida de cada país, porque cada uno nace con unas condiciones diferentes y cada país y cada sistema energético son de alguna forma hijos de una herencia concreta. Hoy lo estamos viviendo en muchísimas de las circunstancias que vive Europa, pues nuclear sí, no, pues ahí estamos, carbón sí, no, ahí estamos, gas sí, no, y ahí estamos, y la evolución de las energías renovables que ha tenido también un desigual desarrollo, ¿no? Yo también querría decir otra cosa, y es que el cómo abordemos esta transición energética no solamente tiene que tener un vector primordial que es de su impacto en el cambio climático, sino que también lo tiene que tener en cuanto a lo que esto impactará en el desarrollo de los países, en el bienestar de los ciudadanos, en el desarrollo económico de los países. No es únicamente uno de los vectores que nos debe guiar a ello, sino que son ambos, ¿no? Y por lo tanto, el término transición es importante porque tiene que ayudar a transicionar a cada uno de los estados y a cada una de las regiones del mundo de donde están a donde deben estar, intentando combinar estos dos aspectos, ¿no? Yo creo también que este respeto de las asimetrías debe comprometer a todos los países, a todas las regiones. Por lo tanto, tan importante es respetar las asimetrías como intentar lograr compromisos de los países, compromisos de las regiones, para que esto permita que hayan planes de acción pragmáticos. Y yo, quizás el último concepto que me gustaría recalcar es el pragmatismo, ¿no? Muchas veces nos vemos abocados a objetivos grandilocuentes, a un plazo muy largo, en donde estamos más preocupados en el punto de llegada que en el camino, porque realmente lo difícil es el camino. Lo difícil es construir el camino y hacer que este camino sea compatible con los dos principios que he dicho antes. Afrontar el cambio climático y afrontarlo desde una perspectiva de que cada uno sea exigente, pero sea consciente de dónde empieza y lo que puede aportar, ¿no? Yo creo que las conferencias de hoy, que se inician hoy, pues espero que sean una senda de muchas conferencias en las que con la visión geoestratégica del Instituto Elcano nos aclaren muchos de los interrogantes. Empezar hoy por Oriente Medio es probablemente empezar por la cuna de este dilema, ¿no?, que empezó hace muchos años y que todos nos acordamos. Algunos, desgraciadamente, ya estábamos en la universidad con la crisis del petróleo y finales de los 70, principios de los 80 en Oriente Medio, pero que después ha ido evolucionando a otros sitios. Y creo que no podíamos empezar tampoco mejor con el panel de expertos que hoy tenemos aquí para debatir lo que se quiere debatir. Por lo tanto, pues primero de todo, bienvenidos de nuevo aquí a la Fundación Naturgy y a Naturgy en sus oficinas. Esperemos que esto sea el inicio de unas interesantes discusiones a futuro, y gracias al Instituto Elcano por haber accedido a hacernos de thinkers en esta aventura. Y gracias a todos por asistir.
Muchas gracias, Francisco. José Juan, desde el Real Instituto Elcano y como think tank de referencia y coorganizador de estas sesiones, ¿cuál fue la motivación principal que vosotros encontrasteis a la hora de la conveniencia de lanzar una iniciativa como esta?
Muchísimas gracias, muy buenos días a todos. Muchísimas gracias, Francisco, por tus palabras de cariño al Real Instituto Elcano. La verdad es que quienes estamos honrados somos nosotros. Elcano es un instituto que se dedica a analizar con independencia y con datos los grandes problemas a los que enfrenta la sociedad española, las empresas españolas, y sin el apoyo de patronos como vosotros, pues sería muy difícil hacer este trabajo. Yo creo que de tu intervención, que suscribo de arriba abajo, hay dos ideas que me parece que son importantes y que pondría un poco en el frontispicio de este seminario. La primera es facta non verba. Yo soy economista y me he pasado toda la vida dando mucha prioridad a los datos. Sin datos no podemos pensar, estamos a ciegas, y tenemos la obligación de todos esos datos ponerlos de una forma comprensible, analizarlos para poder arrojar luz sobre las soluciones, no sobre los problemas, sino las soluciones a los problemas. Y este es el compromiso que Elcano tiene con sus patronos, tiene con la sociedad española: hacer análisis basado en datos. Y solo lo podemos hacer gracias a vuestro apoyo. La segunda idea que me gustaría subrayar es: durante mucho tiempo hemos predicado en el desierto como think tank, porque una parte importante de nuestros oyentes y nuestras audiencias pensaban que la geopolítica era una frivolidad, era un lujo, era algo que solo se podían pagar unos poquitos, que solo tenían que ocuparse de temas más o menos esotéricos. Lo que estamos viendo delante de nuestros ojos, lo que pone de manifiesto es que la geopolítica es una necesidad, el análisis geopolítico es una necesidad no solo de los partidos políticos o de la política, es una necesidad de las empresas y de la sociedad. Porque sin análisis geopolíticos podemos estar tomando decisiones que nos van a llevar a callejones sin salida. Tomen ustedes el caso de lo que está ocurriendo en estos momentos tras la invasión de Ucrania. Yo diría que hay un tema geopolítico esencial. El tema geopolítico esencial es que Europa va a tener que, de una manera u otra, disminuir su dependencia energética de Rusia, y eso significa un shock para todo el mapa de demanda y oferta energética en el mundo. Recambia el precio relativo de nuestras áreas, de los que son más amigos, de los que son menos amigos, y analizar cuáles son las decisiones que en ese cambio de mapa tiene que producirse, que se va a producir, queramos o no queramos, es una obligación de los que nos dedicamos a esto, y estamos encantados de poderla encarar, como decía antes, con datos, con la mejor ciencia que tenemos, con nuestros mejores investigadores como Gonzalo, Lara, la gente que trabaja en el instituto, y ese es un compromiso, hacer esos análisis geopolíticos que son importantes. Pero hay otro tema, que es un tema más estructural. Lo inmediato a veces nos quita y oculta lo que realmente son los vectores de cambio estructural que están ocurriendo. Y esos vectores de cambio estructural que están ocurriendo, como es todo el proceso de políticas contra el cambio climático y la transición energética, son algo que nos van a acompañar y que se superponen a las necesidades de corto plazo. Y un economista como yo sabe muy bien que el medio y el largo plazo se compone y se determina por las decisiones que tomas en el corto. Y que hay soluciones que se codeterminan, que uno no puede tomar decisiones sobre incentivos en el corto plazo sin tener en cuenta las consecuencias deseadas e indeseadas de esos incentivos que ponen y que mueven a los agentes, las inversiones. Estamos hablando de procesos que van a durar 10 años, 15, 20, 30 años. No puede existir una volatilidad de incentivos, o si existe, no podemos predecir cuál va a ser el resultado al que llegaremos, como a veces se intenta demostrar. Por eso es tan importante que podamos sentarnos con datos, con diálogo, con independencia, analizar y ver cómo estas situaciones de corto plazo, las de medio y largo plazo, se interrelacionan. Y si hablamos de cambio climático, pues evidentemente, y hablamos de que el precio relativo de geoestratégico o el valor geoestratégico relativo de algunas regiones del mundo van a caer, es evidente que otras van a subir. Y unas de las que van a subir, sin lugar a dudas, son Oriente Medio. Oriente Medio porque tiene dos características fundamentales. Una, es un gran productor de materias primas, de energía, y en segundo lugar, las decisiones que ellos tomen también van a afectar los planes y los plazos y las posibles estrategias que tengamos. De forma que analizar la geopolítica del cambio climático, no solo desde una perspectiva estrictamente europea, ciegamente europea, sino teniendo en cuenta lo que está ocurriendo en el mundo, es absolutamente imprescindible para poder tomar decisiones correctas. Y por eso es tan importante y tan de agradecer que instituciones tan importantes como nuestro patrón, como Naturgy, esté apoyándonos en este proceso. Es Oriente Medio, pero vamos a tener también que analizar América Latina, vamos a tener que analizar el norte de África. Tenemos un cambio, un shock brutal en el mapa de valor geoestratégico de las zonas productoras de energía y de las demandantes de energía. Y esto hay que ir cerrando el puzzle de una forma sensata, científica y con rigor. Y el último tema es que esto no es un debate banal, no es un debate de salón. Esto tiene consecuencias empresariales y económicas inmediatas. Lo que hagamos, analicemos, veamos como soluciones, va a condicionar enormemente cuál es la sostenibilidad de la prosperidad de muchas de las sociedades. Y hablar de sostenibilidad de la prosperidad también es hablar de sostenibilidad, de nuestras libertades, de nuestro marco democrático y de nuestra coexistencia. Sin esta dimensión económica, social, de integración, creo que es muy difícil analizar los problemas. Y aunque los especialistas tienden a tender a aislar los problemas para poderlos analizar, hace falta tener una visión global. Y hay los think tanks, creo que también podemos tener un buen papel. Yo quisiera acabar con una nota de optimismo. El mundo está muy deprimido. Hay una sensación de que el apocalipsis lo tenemos enfrente. Yo soy un hijo de la Ilustración, creo en el optimismo y creo que la ciencia, el pensamiento, puede ayudarnos a mejorar el mundo, que ese es además el objetivo, aumentar la felicidad. Y creo que hay razones para pensar que no todo está perdido en Europa, que no todo está perdido en España. Machado escribió: el pasado no está muerto, el presente y el futuro no están escritos. Y yo creo que depende de nosotros el poder tomar decisiones que nos permitan generar esa sostenibilidad de la prosperidad y del éxito en el cambio climático. Y hay, yo creo que a veces los españoles no tenemos en cuenta las fortalezas empresariales que tenemos. Gonzalo Escribano ha escrito un ARI en el instituto que se llama 10 contribuciones de España a una seguridad energética europea autónoma de Rusia, que les recomiendo a todos que vayan a nuestra página web y la lean. Solo leeré de su decálogo, solo leeré tres que me parecen importantes. La primera es que España es parte importante de la solución. España tiene capacidad de contribuir porque está menos expuesta al choque energético inmediato y tenemos activos que tenemos que poner en valor. La segunda, que a medio y a largo plazo, siempre, y aquí está el ASIF de los economistas, que se tomen las decisiones correctas. La contribución de España a la autonomía energética de Europa es mayor de lo que ocurre en cualquier o en muchos de los otros sectores de la economía. Es decir, este es un vector de crecimiento y de prosperidad de la sociedad y de la economía española. Y en tercer lugar, que hay empresas en España que pueden construir, que pueden crear ese esfuerzo de transición y de solución de los problemas más inmediatos. Yo con esta nota optimista sobre nuestro papel, que esta vez podemos contribuir más de lo que a menudo se nos reconoce, siempre y cuando los marcos jurídicos y nuestro europeísmo siga sobreviviendo, creo que es una parte muy importante de los debates que vamos a tener en el día de hoy. Agradezco muchísimo a las ponentes y al ponente que nos hayan acompañado hoy, porque estoy seguro que todos ustedes, todos nosotros, vamos a aprender mucho de esa visión del valor geopolítico y qué es lo que está ocurriendo en estos momentos en Oriente Medio. Muchísimas gracias a todos y muchísimas gracias a Naturgy otra vez por su apoyo y, por supuesto, cuenten con nosotros para poder seguir haciendo esto, poner datos en el debate y análisis en el debate para poder encontrar soluciones. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, José Juan y Francisco. Realmente esperamos tener un debate bien interesante que nos ayude a entender un poco mejor la realidad de Oriente Medio y el papel que debe de jugar, sin duda, en la transición energética y las implicaciones que todo eso tiene para la propia región y para el resto del mundo. Bueno, para empezar esta sesión tenemos la fortuna de contar con un primer ponente, que es Bassam Fatou. Bassam Fatou es el director del Oxford Institute for Energy Studies, que empezará con una presentación trasladando la visión que desde el Instituto y la suya propia tienen sobre la región de la que hoy vamos a hablar. Bassam es además profesor de la School of Oriental and African Studies y ha publicado numerosos estudios sobre el sistema de fijación de precios de petróleo, la transición energética y la economía de los países productores. Es además asesor de numerosos gobiernos y compañías. Desgraciadamente, Bassam ha sido ayer, a última hora, víctima de los problemas en el transporte aéreo y vía cancelación de su vuelo en el último minuto, y desgraciadamente, como estaba previsto inicialmente, pues no puede estar aquí con nosotros, pero sí que hemos conseguido organizar su presencia online. Basan, muchas gracias. Thank you very much for joining us. For us, it's a real pleasure having you here virtually with us in this session. And please, the floor is yours.
First of all, thank you, Manuel, for the very kind introduction. And I'm really delighted to be joining you today. And I would like to thank the organizers for the very kind invitation and for this opportunity. I would really have very much loved to join you in person, but the airline had different plans and my flight was canceled. But hopefully there will be other opportunities. So the title of my talk today is the energy transition in the Middle East. And of course, this is a very broad topic. And I'll try to break it down into a few parts. The first one, I will highlight some of the features of the energy transition, which I think are quite important and could impact the Middle East oil and gas producers. And then I will discuss some of the strategies that the Middle East oil and gas exporters can adopt to confront the potential impacts of the transformations in the energy sector on their economies. Finally, I will conclude with a few thoughts on the geopolitics of the energy transition and the importance of avoiding some broad general conclusions that sometimes we hear, especially when it comes to the Middle East. But before doing that, let me start with one observation, and that is the fact that oil rents have brought massive economic benefits to oil and gas exporters. And that actually has been reflected in most socioeconomic and development indicators, though this has happened to varying degrees. Some countries have benefited much more than others from the oil rents. But at the same time, one has to recognize that the heavy reliance on oil revenues has also created its own economic and institutional drawbacks. For instance, the instability and volatility of oil revenues have contributed to macroeconomic instability and very volatile economic growth. Also, there's a wide literature which shows that the distribution of oil rents have contributed to weak institutional environment and many economic distortions. For instance, this includes a weak private sector, which is heavily dependent on the government, very rigid labor markets, wide sort of inefficiencies, subsidies, which tend to distort production and consumption decisions. And all of these have been reflected in a relatively weak economic growth and declining GDP per capita over time, especially as the populations have been increasing. Now, these challenges are going to become much more pronounced as the prospects for oil demand are becoming more uncertain due to the energy transition and decarbonization policies. Now, I don't have any demand projections myself, but I would like to make a few observations when it comes to peak oil demand and the energy transition. The first one is that the oil demand projections are extremely sensitive to the underlying assumptions of the model. These very much depend on the assumptions you make about economic growth, about population growth, about the transformation you see in the transport sector, and the global carbon taxes. And these are just few examples. And actually changing these assumptions, one can push forward or backward the peak by decades. The other observation that I would like to make as well is that it's very important to understand what is the purpose of the exercise. Because sometimes some people are referring to forecasting and some people are referring to backcasting. What do I mean by backcasting? Basically, people assume that we are going to reach our net zero targets by 2050, and then they start working their way back. And of course, there are different paths that you can work your way back. And that's why quite important is that when we're looking at this projection, it's very important to understand the purpose of the exercise, whether it's forecasting or whether it's backcasting. Another observation I would say is that most of the scenarios predict that there's going to be a unique global peak. And then after that, oil demand will decline sharply after reaching this unique peak. Now, in reality, we could see actually other types of scenarios where oil demand could plateau for a long period of time, or we could see actually multiple peaks. So oil demand could decline in certain years and increase in other years, depending on many factors. So this idea that we're going to have only one peak and after that oil demand is going to decline fast after that peak, I think that makes projections, modeling projection, quite simpler, but the world can turn out to be different. And of course, there is no consensus on many of the underlying assumptions. Some of the projections are based on historical trends, which tend to show that fast transition in the energy system has rarely happened, whether other projections are based on the assumption that this transition is quite unique because it involves fighting climate change and is going to be driven by government policy and technological advancements. Now, I would say I would like to just mention a few features of the energy transition, which I think are quite important in the Middle East context, because it will shape their energy policies looking forward. And I would like to mention a few of these. First of all, that the speed of the energy transition is highly uncertain. The second one is that the transition will not be uniform across the globe. The third one is that transition will not be linear. It could be disruptive. There could be setbacks. And the final point, which I would like to emphasize, especially towards the end of my talk, is that there is no single transition path. There are many transition paths out there. However, regardless of the speeds, the impacts of the transition are already being felt. The perceptions and players' behaviors are shifting much, much faster than actual changes in the energy mix. And this is already shaping the energy industry on some key decisions. For instance, if you look in terms of finance, this is the energy transition and perceptions of the changes and the transformation associated with the energy transition are already affecting investors' risk preferences. And this is going to impact financing costs, the availability of finance for hydrocarbon projects, and also the investments going into the sector. It's also already altering the behavior of many players, including the international energy companies, which are adapting their strategies. They are incorporating climate-related objectives into their strategies. They are reducing the share of oil assets in their portfolios. Some of them are increasing the share of gas and renewables, and many of them have been announcing ambitious targets to reach net zero emissions by 2050. Now, when it comes to oil exporters, especially those from the Middle East, they face graver challenges than the international energy companies, and that's for a couple of reasons. The first one is that the proved reserve to production ratios extend for multiple decades. So they face the real challenge of how to monetize a much larger reserve base than international energy companies. So for instance, if you look at international energy companies, the proved reserve to production is measured in years, whereas for the national oil companies and for the countries, this is measured in decades. The other reason as well is that the risk of losses in export revenues could disrupt their socioeconomic well-being, given the high reliance of their economies on oil revenues. So really the key question to me is, what adaptation strategies should oil exporters pursue, given that there are domestic economic and political constraints, there is an energy transition which is changing the prospects of oil demand, but whose speed is uncertain and whose impact is not uniform across the globe, while at the same time we're seeing perceptions, behaviors, and policies changing quite fast. And of course, one of those strategies is to diversify away from the oil and gas sector. And that's what many consultancies and many international organizations tend to recommend. But I would argue that there are real challenges to realize meaningful diversification, particularly fiscal diversification. This requires a massive economic transformation. This requires serious extensive economic reforms, labor market reforms, private sector reforms, human capital enhancement. And there is really uncertainty about how quickly or even whether such extensive economic and institutional reforms can be implemented in most oil and gas exporting countries. Also, one has to emphasize that the oil and gas sector remain very profitable and still enjoy very high margins. And governments can leverage on oil and gas revenues to ease the pains of the structural reforms which are needed to diversify their economic base. Also, I would make another argument as well, that the reduced investment flows into the oil and gas sector can cause supply to fall faster than demand, and this could result in higher margin, at least for short periods of times. So exiting too early from such an established strategic sector deprives the country of an important source of income and a key source of competitive advantage. So that's why perhaps one needs to refine the question a little bit more. If diversifying from the oil and gas sector is suboptimal for the reasons that I mentioned, and it cannot be achieved at a rapid pace, then the question perhaps could be how to enhance the competitiveness and increase the resilience of the hydrocarbon sector in a world that is transitioning towards net zero emissions. And here, the oil and gas exporters face some choices. And one of these is that many of the oil and gas exports, especially those in the Middle East, can compete on cost and actually can take measures to improve the efficiency of production and lower these costs even further. Some of the oil and gas exporters actually can pursue faster monetization and extraction strategies. And that is what is known in the literature as the green paradox. Now, all of these strategies have their limitations, because the lack of fiscal diversification and the high social cost of production acts as a constraint on this strategy. Increasing supply in face of slowing demand would result in much lower revenues, at least in the shorter term. In the longer term, we could see the exit of many producers, and some of the Middle Eastern producers can benefit from the exit of those high-cost producers or those lower-cost producers that are not able to increase productive capacity for a variety of reasons. So that's one aspect that one needs to take into account. The other is that some importing countries may decide to implement high carbon taxes, and this will create a wedge between the revenue generated by oil and gas exporters and the revenue generated by consuming countries, with the consuming countries capturing a big part of the rent as they introduce those taxes. So this is one strategy that oil and gas exporters can pursue, faster monetization, but this has its limitation. The other strategy that oil and gas exporters can pursue is to try to diversify into products and exports closely related to the hydrocarbon sector and energy-intensive industries. Those are industries which those oil and gas exporters have some competitive advantage in. I'm talking about petrochemicals, steel, cement, and fertilizers, and other energy-intensive industries. And this could create actually higher value-added products and can provide a hedge against price volatility, and it can lead to the developments of sectors which have technological spillovers. But again, heavy industrialization into energy-intensive industries increases the domestic emissions of greenhouse gases, and it will make it much more difficult for these countries to meet their climate targets. And of course, one has to take into account the response of importing countries. For instance, importers can develop policies to account for carbon content of final goods, and they could decide to apply border carbon adjustment measures. And again, this will have the impact of capturing part of the rent away from the producers towards to the consumers. So that is why one of the arguments that I've been making is that producers, whether oil and gas, need to ensure that their production processes and core hydrocarbon products can compete also on the emissions front. So the competition should not only be on the cost front, but it also should be done also on the emission reduction. And that actually involves reducing emission in the production process, scope 1 and scope 2, and in the consumption of gas and petroleum products derived from crude and natural gas, basically what people sometimes refer to as scope 3 emissions. And I would argue that some oil and gas exporters are in a relatively better position compared to other producers, especially those in the Middle East. They are in a much better position because of the low carbon content of their crude and because of the heavy investment in infrastructure which some of the countries have implemented in reducing gas flaring and methane emission. And the real challenge to me lies in reducing emission from the consumption of their final of their final petroleum products. Now, one of the things that those countries could do within the energy sphere, of course, is investment in renewables. And this is likely to create new sectors which will have some competitive advantage because the MENA countries, the Middle East countries, you know, they are, have rich solar resources and have rich wind resources. And at the same time, also, they can integrate renewables within the existing hydrocarbon infrastructure, and this would allow them to reduce emissions in their production and the extraction process. And actually, this would allow them also to increase oil and gas export potential without increasing productive capacity, because this will reduce their demand for hydrocarbon products. But again, you know, one needs to emphasize that the margins in renewables cannot fully substitute for the rents generated by the hydrocarbon sector. So this concept that you are going to convert a hydrocarbon exporter and switch them to a renewable exporter, and that could be happen easily, I think that's a wishful thinking. And that's why it's very important to emphasize that the exporters, in addition to investing in renewables, they need to decarbonize their core activities and core exports to compete in a carbon-constrained world. And that is why I've been emphasizing the importance of certain technologies, and particularly the deployment of carbon capture, utilization, and storage, which is needed actually to help the world achieve the goal of net zero emission. And that actually will enable also the oil and gas exporter to be part of the mix, especially that, you know, so far, if you look at most of the projections, they're still expecting oil and gas to remain part of the energy mix. Also, for some energy intensive, hard to abate sectors such as steel and cement, technical options to reduce emissions without CCS are currently very limited. And most of the IPCC scenarios also assume a very important role for CCS. Otherwise, it will not be possible to limit the temperature rise to 1.5 degrees. Now, why I emphasize the CCS? Because I think this is a very important dimension related to oil and gas exporters, because this is a climate mitigation actions through which some oil and gas exporters could establish a competitive advantage. And this is due to the fact that their natural resources, particularly geological storage capacities, their access to depleted hydrocarbon reservoir, and their existing infrastructure. All of these are important factors that oil and gas exporters can exploit to build competitive advantage in these sectors. Also in the technical resources, because they have massive expertise in subsurface technology. And also the deployment of the CCS can provide an opportunity for them to contribute to climate change action. But at the same time, as I mentioned, to try to monetize the reserves in a more sustainable way and retain the competitiveness if they're, of their oil and gas sectors and energy-intensive industries in a carbon-constrained world. And despite the strategic interest for oil and gas exporters to lead on the carbon sink mitigation strategies, what we see is that most of the CCS projects are located in OECD countries. And from an oil exporter, I have always argued that investment in CCUS lowers the returns compared to existing strategy, which is fine, but at the same time, it increases resilience. So you might end up with lower returns, but actually it can increase the resilience of your sector. And not leading on the CCUS fronts could risk undermining their competitive position. But at the same time, shifting the costs to oil and gas exporters alone, I don't think this is viable, especially if the costs are too high. Because after all, the producing countries, especially those in the Middle East, are likely to be most affected by the transition, and there's going to be a lot of competition for limited funds to try to diversify their economies. So that is why it's very important to develop burden-sharing mechanisms, which allows the, a much more inclusive path. And that will include that we think outside the box into new instruments, such as the wellhead carbon taxes, CCA clubs, creating carbon storage units. But this requires harmonization of policies. This requires strong cooperation, either on a multilateral framework or a bilateral framework. And that basically turns me to a very key point that I emphasized in the beginning, is that there are going to be various transition paths, and this is going to depend very much on the starting points, the core competitive advantages of these countries and the existing assets that they hold. Insisting on a single path could delay the transition because it will not enable the use of the technical and financial resources of the producers. It may perpetuate non-cooperative behavior on negotiations and increase the cost of the transitions. And that's why it's very important to provide frameworks that don't discriminate against certain technologies or fuels and allow for technologies to compete. But it also allows that developing burden sharing mechanism between importers and exporters and integrate these into multilateral and bilateral frameworks. And what is really quite encouraging is that we see many of the Middle East oil and gas exporters becoming very active, playing very active role in climate change negotiations. But one also needs to recognize as well that oil and gas exporting countries need to show leadership in mitigation technologies and decarbonization, and that leadership should be on the technological front, on the investment framework, on the business model, and push for frameworks that promote burden sharing mechanisms to offset part of the cost and shield their economies. I do appreciate that this strategy is costly and risky, but so are the alternative technologies. And now let me conclude with just one couple of observations. Many are of the view that the Middle East oil and gas exporters will emerge as the definite losers from the energy transition. And this is based on the premise that oil demand will decline sharply, and as a result of that, we're going to see the erosion of oil rents. And also the importance of oil and gas as a strategic commodity will fall. And as a result of that, we're going to see the geopolitical position of the MENA oil exporters also declining. And in that world, according to this view, we're likely to see oil and gas exporters engaging in a fierce competition for market share in a declining market. And this is going to also lower margins and revenues. And of course, given the undiversified economic structure of oil exporters and rigidity of their government spending, this will result in economic disruptions and instability, and that will destroy the social fabric of these countries. I would argue that this analysis is quite deterministic, it's quite simplistic, and actually it does not help in the way we think about the energy transition. And I would just like to make to conclude with a few observations to why I think this is the case. First of all, MENA oil and gas exporters are not a homogeneous group, and their resilience and core sources of competitive advantage vary tremendously within the region. There are some countries that have the assets, they have the ability to compete in the energy transition world. The other reason as well is that the energy transition can cause dislocations in energy markets that the Middle East exporters or some of them can benefit from and can exploit. And the third point, which is, I think is very, very important, is that some of the key oil and gas exporters are not standing still, and they are evolving and responding to the challenges that the energy transition may bring. So the concept of losers and winners in the energy transition is not useful in the MENA context. I think, you know, we need to recognize that the energy transition will pose real challenges to MENA oil and gas exporters, but the focus should be on whether MENA exporters are prepared to deal with these challenges, whether they are increasing their resilience to the potential disruptions, and whether they are adopting strategies that they could help confront, they help them confront some of these challenges. And I would argue, just to conclude, that some of the MENA oil exporters are in a very good position and a much better position than others, and maybe even in a position to benefit from the transformation associated with the energy transition, and actually can play an important role in that process. So with that, I conclude, and thank you very much for the kind invitation and for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Bassam. A real impressive presentation from your side and about what the energy transition means in the Middle East countries and the implication for the rest of the world with these great challenges we are facing as is the climate change, sustainability, and security of supply. We are now going to move to the next part of the seminar, where we will have a debate with exceptional participants, real true experts, not only in the world of energy, but also in the world of security, and specifically in the area we are in the region we are focusing on today. First of all, we have with us Mariana Liakopoulou. She's Markets and Policy Associate in the European Union Liaison Office of the European Federation of Energy Traders, And she also served as research analyst in energy security with the NATO Association of Canada. It's also with us Noura Mansouri. Noura is a research fellow at the King Abdullah Petroleum Studies and Research Center. Is also a research affiliate at MIT and an expert at the World Energy Council. She has many publications on climate change and sustainability and sustainable energy transitions, and she is the author of the book Greening the Black Gold, Saudi Arabia's Quest for Clean Energy. Noura is also a founder of, and board member of the Saudi Association of Energy Economics. Here with us is also Chloe Berger. Chloe is a faculty advisor and researcher at the NATO Defense College. Her research work focuses mainly on security, political and social economic issues in the MENA region and the implications for NATO. And finally, Carlos Gasco, who is since 2019 the Energy Policy Executive Director of the Department of Energy of the United Arab Emirates. Carlos is an economist and has held various positions in both private companies and public administration in Spain. Of course, all this excellent panel of participants will have to be moderated for another great expert, as Gonzalo Escribano is. Gonzalo directs the Energy and Climate Program of Elcano Royal Institute and is a full professor of economic policy in the Department of Applied Economics of the UNED. His research agenda focuses on international energy issues, geopolitics, geoeconomics of energy, energy security, renewable energies, and the interaction of energy resources with economic development of producing countries. In short, there can be a better person to moderate this great debate. I indicate to all of you that all people who's connected that can send the questions through the platform, you are connected. And here, the people in the auditorium, through the cards that you received at the entrance of the auditorium, that will be collected by the organization if you wish. Thank you very much, all of you, again, for joining us and being here with us. For us, it's a real pleasure and honor. And Gonzalo, it's your turn.
Okay, thank you so much, Manuel, and thank you, Rafael, and the Naturgy Foundation. It's always a pleasure to be here with you. Thank you so much for making this possible, and thank you so much to these great panelists for making it to be with us. I'm going to try to very, very quickly start with the discussions so we don't miss, and we are very time and energy efficient. So I will pose a round of questions to the speakers, and you can answer whatever you want to my questions, to other people's questions, or whatever you want to see. So let's have a frank and open discussion. And I will start immediately with Dr. Mansouri. Noura, may I start?
Yes.
Okay. So I would like you, and I will pose mainly the same question to Carlos. Looking from Saudi Arabia and from a more general regional perspective, how do you, Noura, from Saudi Arabia, and you, Carlos, from the Emirates, how do you see the energy transition from your region?
Thank you very much, Gonzalo, and I'd like to take the opportunity to thank you for the kind invitation. It's a pleasure for me to be here. So thank you for this important question. In fact, the energy transition in the region, and especially in Saudi Arabia and the Gulf, have started a long time ago. In fact, Saudi Arabia has showcased its environmental stewardship since the 70s, when it has decided to stop flaring the gas and instead has founded an industry around hydrocarbons and specifically petrochemicals. But most notably, Saudi Arabia has announced its net zero target by 2060, just before COP26, and has doubled its national determined contributions to 278 million tons of CO2 by 2030. So Saudi Arabia is very much serious about the energy transition and is creating this roadmap towards net zero by establishing so many initiatives. In fact, there's been a lot of announcements around these initiatives, including the Saudi Green Initiatives of planting 10 billion trees across Saudi Arabia, the Middle East Green Initiative for planting 40 billion trees across the region, This is in addition to its ambitions for including 50% renewable energy in its energy mix by 2030, and a number of giga projects that will help in the economic diversification of the country, and this will help in achieving mitigation co-benefits for the climate. We have the blueprint of Vision 2030 that has sustainability at the heart of it, and environmental sustainability, and these giga projects, including the future city of NEOM, which plans to use 100% renewable energy and plans to be the home for the world's largest green hydrogen, to produce 650 tons of green hydrogen daily. And we already have prospective importers of this green hydrogen. Saudi Arabia also exported blue ammonia to Japan. It was the world's first shipment of blue ammonia. So this is evident of using hydrocarbons in a clean way and burning it in a clean way. There has also been a lot of achievements in the Red Sea development projects, the Amala project, which keeps sustainability and regenerative industries in the tourism industry, blue carbon economy, and many other initiatives that keeps the environmental sustainability at the heart of it.
You have to read their papers. I mean, all these people here, you have to read their papers, because they got really, look in their web pages of their institution, because there are really, really wonderful papers, especially you got several ones.
Thank you, Gonzalo.
Very, very worthy to read. I'm going immediately now to Chloe, and we change a little. I mean, coming from NATO Defense College, Chloe, what will be your personal assessment, and I'm expecting, I'm waiting for your disclaimer probably, what will be your personal assessment of the Ukraine crisis for the Gulf and from the Middle East region on your strategic assessment?
So thank you very much. Thank you very much for the kind invitation. I'm really pleased to be here. And so, yes, institutional classical disclaimer that, of course, I'm representing, you know, my own views, not the alliance or NATO Defense College actually views. So having said that, what is, I would say, the impact of the Ukraine war on the Gulf countries? I would say that from a regional perspective, they are probably better placed than other countries in the MENA region. So they have, I would say, from huge wheat imports, but at the same time, huge reserves, small population. If you compare, I would say, this ratio with Egypt or Tunisia, they are definitely, you know, a better place. So this is it from, I would say, a domestic perspective. At the same time, what I can see is the fact that we have European countries trying to reduce their dependency vis-a-vis Russia. And so this implies that they are looking for alternative, I would say, providers of energy supplies. So you have, of course, North Africa, but you have also traditional, I would say, partners in the Gulf. And so this will probably, I would say, rise, you know, new security challenges or reinvigorate, I would say, the tensions that we have seen. They are pre-existing tensions in the Gulf. And so this will, I would say, increase, you know, security-related challenges to, of course, the securitization of shipping routes. You have also all the protection of the, I would say, production infrastructures. And so we have seen that cybersecurity is already something that is really, you know, an ongoing part of the conflictuality in the region. So this raised the question of who is providing security guarantees to the Gulf countries. And so we have seen with this war that obviously there are some, I would say, geopolitical shifts. The Gulf countries have made very clearly that they are not ready to align, you know, on the West or on Russia. They have developed their own, I would say, past, and they are very keen in maintaining, I would say, this, you know, kind of balanced position. And so the problem is that to which extent, I would say, the geopolitical challenges will force those countries to choose. And so one paradox that this war in Ukraine is actually posing is the fact that we have countries that are encouraged to consider, you know, strategic paths and investments to develop, I would say, more sustainable, you know, energy mix. And at the same time, we have a crisis that is forcing European countries to find, you know, quick fix solution for our, I would say, supplies now. So we have countries that are basically compelled to make very quick decisions on structural, I would say, options. And so this is also things that, of course, will have implications on the security side. And so I was referring to security guarantees, to which extent the US will keep being, I would say, the main security provider to those countries. This is something to be seen. To which extent those countries will renegotiate, I would say, the transactional relations they have with the US and have, I would say, alternative options like Russia, but maybe more than Russia, China. And so we all understand that, you know, this will, of course, at a point, maybe collide with, you know, the US, I would say, strategy towards Indo-Pacific, the Indo-Pacific area. So all these components have to be taken into consideration when, I would say, the security challenges are at stake for the Gulf countries. And of course, we have in the region, probably we will see an increase of instability, having in mind, you know, domestic challenges raised by food insecurity connected to Ukrainian and Russian exports of wheat. And so increased domestic instability in the world neighborhood will have, of course, implications for Gulf countries. We have a time where, you know, Gulf countries will be also more compelled to help stabilizing, I would say, the neighborhoods. And so this is all challenges that, I mean, the Gulf countries will have to solve. In, I would say, a separate or bilateral, you know, path or as a GCC. And so this is also a very good question, to which extent this crisis will help the GCC countries, I would say, close the chapter about their own divides, or on the contrary, will exacerbate, I would say, those divides. This is still to be seen.
That's fascinating. I see the next NATO summit here in Madrid, they will get a lot of homeworks to do, probably on the energy matter too.
Yes, definitely.
Okay, we move now to Carlos. And Carlos, I will ask you exactly the same question that I asked to Nora. What is the regional perspective on the energy transition from the Emirates? But in your case, you can have a dual perspective. Also, not only how do you see it, but how to explain this to we Europeans?
Right. Oh, thank you, Gonzalo, very much. And thank you to the Naturgy Foundation and to Real Instituto Elcano for having me here. It's just amazing to actually be here today discussing, sharing some thoughts, hopefully sharing some light as well. Just like Chloe, I also need to, you know, say my own little disclaimer. All my opinions are personal. I am not here in the representation of the official position of the Department of Energy of Abu Dhabi. But I am here, obviously, with my experience and everything that I can provide to the debate in an open, transparent, and hopefully interesting way. I would take advantage of that disclaimer to be a little bit provocative for the sake of the discussion, for the sake of the debate. Just, I would like everybody to think that you could fly, that you could go away, because what we do here in this part of the world tends to be, you know, quite robust from a technical or from an analytic point of view, but it's also narrow. The one thing that I've learned in the last 4 years when I've been working outside of Europe is that the world is a lot bigger than Europe and much bigger than Spain. So just go somewhere else and put yourself in the shoes of someone in the Middle East, in the shoes of someone in a developing nation, maybe in India, maybe in China, maybe somewhere in Latin America or in Africa, and think of the debate today, the energy transition. The energy transition is great. Everybody likes the energy transition. The Germans had this Energiewende, which is we need to move, we have to change. But is it a European issue? Is it a Western priority? Or is it a global priority? And when we look at what it wants to achieve and what is happening, we need to think twice, I think. because the energy transition is about sustainability, security of supply, and affordability. And if we look at what happens, and now put yourself, as I said, in the shoes of someone who is 7,000 kilometers away from here and looks at these three things. Emissions are increasing. We are already above the emissions levels, pre-pandemic levels. So that is not working, at least not as much as it should. Maybe it's working compared to what would happen if, but the reality is we are above. The second is security of supply, energy security. We just realized that we have a massive issue, right? And it costs money, which links to the third thing, the affordability. So we put all these efforts in our policies, in our strategies, in our language, in the corporate behaviors, in the government behaviors, everything, and what we collect. I'm not saying that we're failing, but I'm saying that we're not succeeding. Let's say we could do better, right? So the Middle East is right in the middle between the East and the West. And at the same time, the Middle East is providing hydrocarbons, you know, to the economies of the East and the West. So, and at the same time, the Middle East is witnessing, like everybody, why these things in the energy policy, in the energy transition are failing or not succeeding, at least. And I would say, you know, as I said, to be a bit provocative, I think we think, or it could be said, that there is a lack of realism in the definition of the policies of the energy transition. We've been speaking about renewables and all of these green transition, but we didn't realize that we also needed the hydrocarbons to do part of the job. And, you know, it just suddenly we emerge from the pandemic and the supply is rigid and the demand skyrockets and the prices spike. So that's the one thing. The second thing is, if it's so important and if the problems are the emissions related to the hydrocarbons, why don't we take them seriously? Why don't we tax or why don't we price the emissions? Why don't we phase out the technologies? If the problem is global, why don't we help the economies? They cannot pursue their own goals the way they have to fight the global problem. And this is seen by the world. And the third issue is, are the technologies there for us? We speak about things for 2050, but we don't know really how we're going to achieve them, you know? Energy storage is fundamental. Do we have the ability? Is the energy transition a mining transition? Because we will need a lot of minerals and materials to build that storage, to make this energy transition happen, but are there for us? And if they are, where are they? Are we substituting some of the energy dependency from a mineral dependency? Is this electrostates? Are they actually mining states? And lastly, we put faith in things which are, to some extent, still unproven. Hydrogen. I mean, it looks great on paper, but when you go and speak to an airline and say you have to fly your airplanes with hydrogen, and then this is, well, I don't think I can. And maybe I can technically, but can I afford it? When you say I will, you know, excess capacity in the summer or in the winter, depending on the jurisdiction, I will store it in the form of hydrogen and then deliver seasonal storage, which is what we need for the renewables and all that, with an efficiency of 15%. So we need to take the air, CO2 from the atmosphere directly if we need to succeed, but we still don't know how to do it, or maybe we do, but it's not affordable. So we need to recognize that the energy transition is fundamental, it's important, but it's not easy or cheap. And if we don't come to terms to that, we will still run around in circles. And this is what is seen from the Middle East, but I think this is what is seen from everywhere. And this is what some people out there, not Europeans, call the Western hypocrisy. Because we do all these things, we have this language, but at the same time, we don't do other things. But we tell everybody how they should, let's say, behave. So now, back to the original question, the Middle East. I can speak, and this was trying to answer just your second part of the question. Okay. But the first one is, what does the energy transition mean for the Middle East, and in particular for the UAE? Well, it means business. It means opportunities. It means change. It means diversification. It means moving from an old paradigm into a new paradigm. But, this is a very big but, the Middle East produces the cleanest, most competitive oil and gas that there is anywhere. It will continue to sell these products for decades to come. What it means is the uncertainty of not if you will sell them, because it's been said before, some players with higher costs will have to be pushed out of a shrinking cake. But how much money will you make? This is a commodity. So small price or differential will generate an important impact on your revenues or cost differential. So that is what it means. It means volatility, it means uncertainty, and it means a challenge to move from the already volatile oil markets or hydrocarbon markets into a more resilient, more stable, more predictable economy. And that means, instead of focusing on the molecules or the electrons, focusing on the industrial processes, focusing on the real economy, and using those competitive advantages as an input for that, and the generation of added value, which is the quest of the region. That's what we're working on. That is the primary driver. We don't want to make in the UAE the cheapest molecule of green hydrogen. We want to take out the most value of that molecule in an industrial process. I would rather have a, not me personally, again, I would rather have a factory to do green aluminium, green steel, or batteries or cars made with locally sourced competitive hydrogen than fighting with someone for a market share of a potential future hydrogen market. That is really a completely different paradigm. So I think, just to finalize, because maybe I'm speaking a bit too much, I think the energy transition is for real. Both Saudi and the UAE are compromised to a net zero future, 2050 in the case of the UAE. We just approved in the Emirate of Abu Dhabi interim renewable and clean energy targets for 2035. 60% of all the electricity will be clean. There is a huge effort in evolving the energy mix, but there is also a huge effort in realizing that it's not just about the investment in the electricity or the energy sector, is evolving the economy to a new, let's say, more resilient, less volatile future. And this is the focus of the area.
Thank you so much, Carlos. Very, very comprehensive. I will turn now to Mariana. Mariana has worked a lot on carbon markets in the EU and the Gulf and linkages on that. Among many other issues, but on that I would like to ask you, what can you tell us, Mariana, what potential, what linkages can we establish between eventual carbon markets in the Gulf? How would that work?
Yeah, so thanks a lot, Gonzalo, and thanks a lot to Real Elcano Instituto and to Naturgy Foundation for the kind invitation. It's very nice to be with you here today. So let me start by saying something that I've written before. I think that when it comes to carbon pricing, the Middle East can actually benefit from the design and scope of an inclusive cap and trade system, such as the EU emissions trading system, for two reasons. First, for the establishment of national cap and trade systems emulating the EU ETS, and second, for the prospective establishment of a regional carbon pricing scheme emulating the EU ETS and linked with it. Now, why is this important? To basically offer the Middle East and North Africa region a cost-effective way out of awkward measures of the sort of a carbon border adjustment mechanism. Because at the end of the day, putting a price on the carbon content of imports will constitute a problem for exports of oil, exports of gas, and other energy-intensive exports from the region to Europe. Now, what I would like to focus and I would like to discuss with you here today are the reasons why these efforts have been unsuccessful so far in the region. And I would like to start by saying that carbon pricing is unfortunately largely unfavored in predominant sectors of these economies, such as oil and gas upstream operations, petrochemicals, refining, to name a few. Of course, always in the with a potential in the fear of a potential economic detriment. Now, industrialization in the Middle East and North Africa region, and even efforts towards the region's economic diversification are primarily driven by energy-intensive industries. And why am I saying that? I'm saying this because energy-intensive industries run the risk of becoming less competitive should carbon pricing be implemented. And another reason has to do with the persisting energy subsidies that we see in the region, which offset carbon pricing. But here, I would like to quote research by Paul Vanson, actually, highlighting that fossil fuel subsidies, including through electricity prices, have already been gradually reduced in the region, coming down from $400 billion USD in 2012 in the MENA alone. And of course, this process has been, needless to say, overall difficult to carry out due to the financial impact on society. However, the greater the penetration of renewable energies, which do not need subsidization per se, for example, tenders for photovoltaic systems in the UAE that we've seen, then the less the need for state support, at least beyond the, you know, an initial period for markets to kickstart. And a third, perhaps, reason making implementation even more challenging is, in my opinion, the prominent economic feature of state-owned enterprises, at least in the GCC, energy, and heavy industry sectors. And here I would like to include monopoly state oil and utility firms. So this kind of increases the risk for political lobbying against carbon pricing. So finally, the momentum for collective action is sort of hindered by the, I would say, possibility that if a GCC country, if a Middle Eastern country unilaterally legislates for and applies a carbon mitigation strategy on its own, then you're going to have joint venture partners and non-state controlled energy-intensive industries fleeing to a neighboring country with less stringent regulations. So that would be the three reasons, at least from where I stand. And for this reason, implementation of consistent carbon pricing strategies per GCC country and collective action are critical for the establishment of a regional carbon trading scheme. And now this process, and I would like to conclude with that, is largely contingent on the momentum of implementation of the newly revised Article 6 of the Paris Agreement on rules for cooperative implementation of carbon targets. And at the same time, it is also important to take into account the European debate. And that is that the EU emissions trading system is also subject to further development under the Fit for 55 package through its proposed expansion and the establishment of a second emissions trading system for transport and buildings. There is also here the additional parameter on voluntary carbon markets that I know that Gonzalo, you and I have discussed. I don't know if I have a bit of time. It's up to you. You are the manager
here. Go for it. Go for it.
Okay. And I would like to point out to you the complexity entailed when it comes to VCMs, the complexity when it comes to creating greenhouse gas verified claims for methane emissions from oil imports, due to the complexity given the different oil grades, their transportation, and the different refining processes, as noted by our colleague at the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies, Adim Sirovic, in his very informative paper. And this is particularly important for the purchase, say, by, I don't know, a Mediterranean refinery of Middle East crudes in terms of the diverging refinery margins of those crudes and the adjustment of those margins based on the underlying carbon price. And the same amount of complexity is entailed in the certification of carbon removals from technology-based or nature-based CCUS solutions, which are going to drive decarbonization of gas produced in the MENA region, as Bassam also pointed out. In this case, as you know, Europe intends, or perhaps you know, intends to put forward a regulatory framework for the certification of those technologies by the end of the year. We, as IFED, at least hope that this framework will ensure commonality of certification instruments at the EU level and will also incentivize deployment of all carbon dioxide removal technologies as soon as declared commercially viable. And I think that's also a very important parameter to point out when it comes to our relations with the MENA countries.
Sure. Thank you, Mariana. Thanks a lot. Let's go back to Nora. Nora, you gave us a general perspective, but I would like to go you to go more into the details, like, for instance, about all this about the circular carbon economy, all the Saudi climate targets, all the energy transition ambitions. What can you tell us with more detail on those issues?
Thank you, Gonzalo. So the circular carbon economy was proposed by Saudi Arabia during the 2020 G20 summit in Riyadh, and it was endorsed by all the G20 countries. The what the circular carbon economy contributes to climate mitigation is that it provides a transition towards low carbon economy in a very holistic and inclusive and pragmatic way. So it shifts the discussion really from talking about energy sources to shifting and talking about managing the emissions from these energy sources. And it's something that was touched upon by earlier in the opening remarks by the president of Naturgy when he talked about the customized energy transition. And it was also reiterated by our colleague Bassam Fattouh from Oxford Institute when he discussed the importance of keeping the options open in the energy transition and not forcing a single transition pathway. So the circular carbon economy is based on the four pathways, the four R's: reduce, reuse, recycle, and remove carbon and greenhouse gas emissions. So it provides so many options for countries based on their national circumstances, based on their national endowments. So every country can customize their energy transition based on its energy security needs, its economic plans, and its current energy mix and going from where it is today and where it needs to go in the future. So technologies such as carbon capture and utilization and storage, which was discussed heavily today, is an important technology as it allows the continued participation of the continued use of hydrocarbons, which is, according to all the forecast, is going to be increasingly important energy source. But it also, more importantly, allows the participation of the hard-to-abate sectors that are locked in hydrocarbons to participate in this energy transition. So it really highlights the importance of not discriminating against a certain set of energy technologies or energy sources, as this will have many implications. This was also discussed earlier. It will increase the cost of the transition. It will make the energy transition abrupt and not as smooth, and so on and so forth. And the hard-to-abate sector specifically make up over a third of the global CO2 emissions. So not allowing these sectors to participate in the energy transition is a grave a grave issue. So technologies like carbon capture, utilization, and storage need to be invested in, and also hydrogen, for instance, which we see as a cross-cutting technology in its different colors. Blue hydrogen using CCS. And green hydrogen using renewables and other colors. So it's important to look at hydrogen as clean hydrogen and also not discriminate based on color. The circular carbon economy also allows countries to define their own targets, their own NDCs, and their own energy transition at the pace that is reasonable for these countries. So for Saudi Arabia, since you asked, Saudi Arabia is using the circular carbon economy approach to meet its net zero target So in this map towards this roadmap towards net zero, it has so many initiatives along these circular carbon economy approach, and the deployment of CCE in the region is also something important, and in the Gulf countries, the oil exporting countries more specifically, as it helps hydrocarbons industry to transition towards carbon circularity. And this is important because we don't look at the emissions coming out of the hydrocarbons and in energy emissions in general as only a negative externality, but we look at it as an important feedstock for the industry, which is something that Carlos touched upon earlier in the discussion. So how can we use these as raw materials, as important feedstock for the hydrocarbons industry towards circularity for a win-win situation between, you know, this classic delicate balance of balancing the SDGs and meeting these sustainable development goals, specifically SDG 7 on energy access and SDG 13 on climate action. So how can we balance between the two towards a more inclusive, sustainable energy transition?
Great, awesome, very clear. Thank you so much for that. Let's go now to Chloe. I get a question for you. On, you partially touched upon it, but if you could elaborate a bit more on which impact do you think the current energy security crisis we're undergoing in Europe and the way it will unfold will impact NATO allies' energy security policies or strategies or perceptions?
So I think that there is a dangerous trend. This is my personal view again. This securitized approach to energy policy. I think that obviously the key of a reduced dependency vis-a-vis Russia lies in the south. Okay, so what we call in NATO or for transatlantic security, this grand southern periphery that, you know, ranges from I would say roughly Sahel to Afghanistan, Pakistan. And so, of course, I mean, European countries are heavily dependent on Russia's, supplies, especially for countries like Germany, Italy. This is super obvious. So now the question is that how do you, mitigate this dependency? So you are looking for new, providers. So Algeria is one, Egypt is another. You have also in the Eastern Med, promising prospects. But all, those options are bringing to the table a lot of geopolitical rivalries and complexities. And so this is not, it's not because we are looking at the Med, this is disconnected from what is happening in the Gulf. Look at what are today, foreign projection or the ambitions of some of the Gulf countries in Northern Africa. We have, an increasing pattern of, governance of the Mediterranean basin. So this is something that cannot be solved out, on a short term. The problem is that we are looking for short-term solutions. At the same time, we have countries that have, capacity to increase probably their production, but to a certain level. I'm not sure that by the summer, when we will try to, renew our stocks, those countries will be able to fill all the gaps. And so this implies that we invest, and when I'm saying we, I'm saying Europeans, we invest, in the infrastructures in those countries. So here comes the problem of, domestic instability. That, of course, if you are investing, you need to have, secure prospects or minimum secure conditions or stable conditions. So this is for the country where, resources are produced. You have also the problem linked to transit. And so here, of course, we can see that if you want to, of course, have an alternative path to Russia, so you have the southern corridors. So this is crossing Caspian, Middle East. So obviously, places where you have a lot of instability. You have also, the Eastern Med. You have, all these pipes that are crossing the Med. So this is, I would say, bringing an additional layer on, I would say, a complex package of security issues that tends to be very much intertwined. And so what we need to have in mind is that at the moment, where allies are looking very much to the east, we need to be, I would say, cognizant to the fact that at the end of the day, you know, challenging the challenges that are pre-existing to this crisis in the south are not going anywhere. So we will have a resource or a capabilities issue. If we are speaking only, you know, from a military point of view, I would say collective defense, we will still have to provide collective defense for the Met. And then, in addition to that, we will have, you know, crisis management issues that we need still to take care of. And so this brings the question of who is providing capabilities. And so do we have the means to increase, I would say, our capabilities? And this is not only about money spending. You know, this is not about only increasing military spending. You need to have military spending that are matching, I would say, capabilities available on the shelves. And so from that perspective, I would say that European industrial cooperation, unfortunately, is not well placed, because only the US will be able to probably provide, you know, all the equipment and resources that we need to acquire. So this is part of, I would say, the global complexity that this war in Ukraine is bringing. We have geopolitics backs, you know, at the heart of Europe. And we have, I would say, a bit forgotten that. Geopolitics was something that was very much linked to the Gulf or, you know, to the Sahelian periphery. And so we have, you know, the geopolitical stakes, and today we have to deal with, I would say, a continuum of, you know, geopolitical challenges that starts high north and run, you know, till the Sahel or a little bit south, down further south in, I would say, sub-Saharan Africa. So wherever you will have to shift, you know, priorities, you will need to find alternative solutions. So for the allies, this brings the question of how do you share the burden? And so this is an additional complexity to a very old, I would say, conversation about burden sharing between both sides of the Atlantic. And so here, and because the Madrid Summit is very close, we are expecting to have, I would say, a renewed impetus for NATO-EU cooperation. But of course, this is, you know, bringing, I would say, this prospect within a totally different framework. And so having European allies competing for very short-term solution to secure their supplies, this is also something that undermines cohesion. And so cohesion is our center of gravity. I mean, either in EU or in NATO. So this is where, you know, I see that we are, I mean, having a vicious cycle, and we need to find out, you know, the means to get out of this cycle. The problem this is very much depending of, I would say, national interest. And so to which extent European allies will be able to reconcile, you know, their national interest. This is linked to sanctions on Russia, what would be, you know, the consequences on our economies. And this is totally understandable at the end of the day.
Okay, let's go back to Carlos, and I will ask you, well, you already mentioned some of the hallmark projects or flagship projects you got in the Emirates, but I don't know if you want to highlight something, not only in the Emirates, but perhaps look into some kind of cooperation that we can do together, you know, between the EU and the Emirates. I mean, during this current crisis, is there some kind of support or cooperation that we can, I mean, as just Claude said, I mean, we have to look for new partners and new commitments. What do you think?
Sure, thank you, Gonzalo. It's an extremely complicated question to answer. I will try to say something meaningful. And obviously, you know, the discussion is there for us. I mean, the region and the UAE in particular and the European Union, in reality, they share their goals. We both want to be net zero by 2050. And we both, you know, face not exactly the same, but there are a number of similar issues or challenges that we need to look at. In the case of the UAE in particular, I will mention a few things which will then take me, you know, to a shared reflection about how to approach them and how to collaborate between these two regions. The UAE has a very ambitious nuclear program and a very ambitious photovoltaic program. The UAE wants to have a 60% reduction of emissions in the electricity sector in 2035 and be nearly zero by the end of 2050. The UAE has an electrification strategy. All the buildings are electric in the UAE, so we have to focus on transport and hard to decarbonize industrial processes. The UAE has to develop sustainable, clean and green hydrogen as, you know, a potential solution or part of the solution to the 2050 challenges. We need to look at things like the governance, the target model, because it's not so simple, you know, to realize how this is going to run among the different players in the region, the business models, the electricity supply, the availability of land, the certification scheme, the use of different structures. All of these things are not written yet. We need to work on those. And so does Europe, by the way. We need to also look at things like energy efficiency, which is, you know, the elephant in the room. We cannot meet our goals without some things like energy efficiency and demand side management. We cannot just, you know, have these one-way street for everything. We need to allow the consumer to participate in the process. And we need to do institutional reforms. We see things which are shocking, at least if you think for a second. We see that renewables are more and more competitive in terms of cost, but electricity continues to be expensive. So maybe let's think on what kind of institutional arrangements we need to have in the marketplace to figure out. And I'm not talking about capping anything. I'm just thinking about how to, you know,
this is take about an elephant in the room, by correct. The way.
how to look at these, all of these. So my point is here is technology, institutional reform, and you know, enablers for the energy transition have plenty of common ground between these two jurisdictions. I would really welcome, you know, a shared approach to increase the information flow, the missions and the visions that actually need to happen between these two regions, to choose two or three critical items and to see to what extent there is cooperation is happening. I see from there, that parts of Asia are very present. China is playing an ever-growing role in the region. And I see that some countries in Europe, or the UK, if it's in Europe still, I'm not sure, have also a very close relation with the region. But the European Union, as such, maybe could be more present and share, you know, the knowledge and the institutional excellence that we enjoy in this part of the world. Because some of those answers are not only technological, it's how you get there. So,
for how long are we waiting for a free trade area between the GCC and the European Union? I mean, it's 30 years now?
I mean, at least. So, I mean, that is what I think. And finally, research, innovation, technology is going to be and will be the cornerstone of the whole success story. This is a clear area of collaboration. There should be competition in this area. So that would be my last addition to the list.
Thank you, Carlos. I'm going to start to offset questions and answers rather than we go to capture questions and storage, because if not, we are not being able to do it. But hopefully some of the questions that I was thinking of posing to Mariana has been also posed by the audience, and it refers to hydrogen. What will be the prospects for hydrogen in the Middle East? You have already mentioned something, Noura, but Mariana, you have worked a lot on that. What can you tell us on that?
Yeah, thanks, Gonzalo. I don't want to start again saying, like, you know, as I've written before, but you you have cited the papers of several of us during the past couple of minutes. So yes, decarbonization, including decarbonization of the European economy through hydrogen, and I'm saying that when it comes to our relations with the Middle East countries, yes, it may to a certain extent depoliticize interstate energy relations, and it is likely to limit geopolitical competition, like for access to fossil fuel reserves and supply, which is a shift from the post-World War II geopolitical literature, which was more centered towards you know, competition over petroleum resources and so on and so forth. Now, at the same time, yes, sure, the energy transition narrative puts into question the conventional energy security motive, but it seems that key threats, such as, I don't know, politically or economically motivated regional conflict, as we've seen these days, so these threats will still and for quite some time constitute an underlying, you know, reason, you know, underlying disruption incidents affecting both importers and exporters alike. So looking at the opportunities emerging from our conventional gas market, I would say first to have a look at the numbers, okay? So 2021, when it comes to the region, Algeria, oil-indexed imported pipeline gas came fourth with a share of 10.5% in the around 3,630 terawatt hours of gas imports in the EU as a whole. In this case, and that's also for future consideration, we have to take into account the dependence of the competitiveness of oil-indexed contracts on the evolution of gas hub prices and how this dependence, again, based on what we've been experiencing over the past couple of months, may create a competitive advantage for oil-indexed gas importers from the MENA, exporters, not importers, whenever and as long as you have this premium of spot contracts increasing over them. Second number that I would like to bring to your attention, Qatar becoming the second principal import source of LNG to the EU in 2021 with a share of 16.3 BCM out of a total 80 BCM of imports. In this case, we have to bear in mind two things, and I'm turning to your question about energy system integration, Gonzalo, and hydrogen. A, Qatar's current lack of spare LNG export capacity, although, and as Carlos might also well know, this is about to change with the lifting of the moratorium on the North Field expansion, and Qatar's long-term contractual commitments with Asian buyers. Second thing that we have to take in mind on the positive side, the low carbon intensity rate in Qatar's LNG supply chain and its commitment to, you know, increase this intensity by 35% by 2035 through CCS. And finally, and here allow me to quote CAPSAC research, we have the resource perspective, on the other hand, of prospective exporters from a sector coupling point of view, again to your question, Gonzalo, such as Saudi Arabia, which has both significant hydrocarbon reserves and high renewable energy potential, which is a fact significantly reducing both its natural gas and renewable electricity sourced hydrogen production costs. So this advantage may allow Saudi Arabia to become a major producer, A, and B, a low-cost global marginal supplier of low-carbon hydrogen if international trade in hydrogen develops. And one last thing, if I have a bit of time, because we're talking about, you know, this nexus with the European Union, it's also a matter of Europe's trajectory towards an established hydrogen market. Because when it comes to spot markets in particular, the hydrogen system does not exist in isolation. So the hydrogen system is going to be about close interrelations between natural gas and electricity markets. And that they will all have a requirement for physical balance or optimization. And this is exactly what energy system integration will be about. So there is going to be, you know, pricing interactions between this and all of this. And we know, for example, that you can develop salt caverns for hydrogen and that there's going to be a line pack in hydrogen systems. So there will be seen as a single system to be optimized amongst traders as long as the markets are established properly. So you have the Middle East and North Africa region trying to find its place in a market under construction, let's say.
Thank you, Mariana. Thank you so much. We are going to the last round, and we are going to mix some questions from the audience with some questions I got myself. So I go back to Noura. There was that question, nitrogen in Saudi Arabia, but I think you have already answered. But if you want to complement or to elaborate further, that's your point. But I would like to ask you, going back to a more general trend, how do you see the role of the Middle East and the Gulf countries in the energy transition? What can the region contribute to the rest of the world?
Thank you, Gonzalo. So the Middle East is a very important region for energy and for other important aspects of the global security. You know, the Middle East comprises about 18% of oil and, 38% of oil and 18% of gas. It exports that to the world. And Saudi Arabia specifically is the global de facto leader in energy. And even with this energy transition, this role can be continued, especially looking at the potential of renewable energy in the region and in the country, as well as the important role, the potential important role in hydrogen. As we discussed, Saudi Arabia plans to be the world's largest green hydrogen producer, and there's been a lot of agreements and signing of agreements with other countries as potential importers of this hydrogen. So in general, the Middle East country has abundant, you know, solar energy potential as well as renewable energy potential, and there is a lot of potential in integrating the energy and the electricity grid, and so that provides a golden opportunity for exchange of energy and exporting of electricity, clean electricity, to Europe and the rest of the world. I'd like to also highlight the Middle East Green Initiative, which is a climate mitigation initiative by Saudi Arabia, as it's funding the afforestation of 40 billion trees across the region. And so the participation of the Middle East in the energy transition is important. But of course, the Middle East is not a homogeneous region. You have energy exporters, you have energy importers as well, and there are various contexts to these countries. But I could say that the region, the Middle East region, should participate more in climate adaptation, given the needs of the countries. For instance, you know, a lot of these countries are very water poor, particularly the GCC. The water poverty, as defined by the UN, is at 2,000 cubic meter per capita, and the critical water poverty is at 500. And unfortunately, all the GCC countries are below that. So they're critically water poor countries that highly depend on desalination, which highly depends on hydrocarbons for now. But there are many efforts for using renewable energy in the desalination. There's also very high temperatures that are really, you know, touching upon the physiological limits of humans. So you will need constant air conditioning and cooling, and so that also is dependent on hydrocarbons. So you have these needs for adaptation, climate adaptation, but you also have serious plans for climate mitigation through all these efforts in energy transition. So the Middle East's efforts in this energy, grand energy transition globally, is very important.
Thank you so much for raising the question of adaptation. We never talk enough about adaptation, especially in the region, you know. So thank you so much, Noura. I go back immediately to Chloe. My question, Chloe, and there is also a question related to this from the audience, is, okay, Bassam has told before, and you have been mentioned, risk and opportunities about the energy transition for the Gulf countries, but how can we approach this from a NATO perspective? I mean, do you see all these things, and Bassam was saying, beware of simplistic assumptions, you know, that this is going to be winners and losers, very clear-cut, but what's the perspective from a NATO? What's your perspective when you look at it from a security perspective? How this energy transition can further complicate the already complex situation in the Gulf and the region?
So I would say that if we are looking at, you know, this is the triangular, I would say, relation. So you have, of course, the consumer perspective, the producer perspective, and you have the transit perspective. And so you need to consider security, I would say, risks or vulnerabilities, you know, from the different perspectives and how they can, you know, conflict or how you can find a solution scenario that, you know, is trying to compromise, I would say, interests. So from the consumer perspective, I can say that from the moment we are actually transferring risks. And so we have a problem because we are already dependent. So we mean that it means that we lack, you know, diversifications in terms of resources. But we are at the moment actually just transferring that. So we are not diversifying our risk. And so this is a big problem from, I would say, the consumer perspective. So if we are transferring, I would say, our interests, you know, on the Middle East, which is for, I mean, look at the figures that have been mentioned. It says already LNG from Qatar, they are already, you know, exporting a lot of gas and supplying gas, almost 100% to Belgium, UK. This is really big numbers. So the problem is that this dependency implies that you need to help those countries ensuring their own stability. And so also from the transit perspective, there are a lot of risks that are linked, of course, to, I would say, LNG shipping. So it's, I mean, getting back to maritime security. So this raised the questions of how are we stabilizing the Mediterranean basin, which is from a NATO perspective, I would say collective defense, but you need to also consider, I mean, the world route. And so we have here Red Sea. You go down to the Gulf of Aden, I mean, not mentioning what is happening in Yemen and how much, you know, this is obviously impacting the decisions of the players in the region. Look at, I mean, UAE was embarrassed because they were, you know, expecting, or at least they wanted to avoid to have, you know, Russia, I would say, you know, modifying a decision on Yemen. So this is just a very punctual example. So we can multiply those complex linkages to the security interests of those countries. So this is maritime security, classic for the Gulf. The problem is that now, if you are developing renewables, you will develop new infrastructure, and so you will develop new grids, and so you will have new interconnectivity, okay, to be ensured with other markets. And so this brings the question of how do you secure all this infrastructure. So cyber, but not only cyber, you have also, I would say, art, I would say, security issues that needs to be, I would say, taken into consideration. So this raised the questions of, I would say, security and armed forces capabilities, you know, in those countries. And so their ability to function, I would say, independently from a strong Western support. So there is here this interdependency that needs to be worked out. And so we have seen that in certain cases, when technologies is not delivered, those countries, and this is their sovereign prerogative, okay, they are looking for alternative options. And so Russia is one of those options, but we know that sanctions will probably impact also the defense industrial complex of Russia. So very soon they won't be able anymore to deliver, you know, one of this, I would say, you know, capabilities from the high end of spectrum. But this opened the questions of China. And so here we are already seeing that China is providing a lot of solution from a security perspective. So the problem is that Chinese investments in those, I would say, connectivity projects, I mean, I don't know if no. this is a risk or an opportunity. But
this
I would
for,
say
this is for next year.
I would say that I mean, some allies, to be very diplomatic, already considers, I mean, this was I mean, great worries. And so this is a problem, having too much investments from one country, anyway, this is China or this is another country, and those infrastructure, I mean, raise concerns. This is true for the Gulf, 5G, not, you know, no necessity to mention other technologies. And so this is also true, I would say, in North Africa. So we have, you know, all these connectivity projects. Yep. If we want to develop renewables in North Africa, we need to be able to provide technologies at, I would say, an affordable price. And the problem is that you have affordable price, but you have also to have, I would say, political agreements that are allowing those countries to interconnect their markets. And so, for example, in North Africa, you see that political divides are actually very much impacting, you know, regional integration. And so this is true for North Africa. This is super obvious. But on the Gulf, we have also political divides. So this is also a question. Can you, I would say, provide for the future clean energy solution without having a GCC interconnected market? I don't have an answer. You have Iran that is still there and still something that the Gulf countries will have to deal with. So I would say from that perspective, I see that there are probably a lot of risk, but I'm sure that if you have a concerted solution, okay, and regional integration is, from my perspective, probably the best solution, you have also a lot of opportunities.
I see. I know I'm running out of time, but I will ask for 5 more minutes for 2 opponents, and then I give you the floor, Rafael, if you don't mind. May I? Because I would like to finish, because there are questions for you. Can you do it in 2 minutes, Carlos? One question about the mineral issue, the mineral transition you mentioned, and related to China. I mean, in the region, there are concerns about new dependencies from rare earths or minerals or whatever regarding China?
Well, in the region and everywhere, right? We are going to a new paradigm where electrification is a must. Electrification, not just with any means, electrification with renewables and clean technologies. And those technologies are intensive in a number of minerals which are located in limited amounts in specific countries. So we might be, and this is a huge issue that I think will impact the energy transition, you know, over a period of time, we are going to have to solve that if it's possible, or assume that there will be a dependency of the electrification and the energy transition from these materials. And I think that is not something specific to the Gulf or to the UAE, that is a global concern.
And I finish with Mariana, a very easy and very short question. What is the role of the Middle East region in the current energy crisis in Europe, in 2 sentences? No, I mean, you got 2 minutes.
Thanks.
Try to do, because I know that you got this holistic vision that you can put together energy, geopolitics. This is why I'm keeping that question for you.
No. Here, the question is very simple. Whether or not the MENA region evolves into a sort of energy powerhouse for its own people and for Europe at this stage. Addiction to hydrocarbons and, if you like, those untaxed prices at which you have petroleum products, at which you have natural gas, electricity, still mostly generated using gas or diesel, okay? Not compliant, diversion from a climate compliant perspective. And so does the absence of any direct control or on carbon emissions by way of a carbon tax or regional carbon pricing scheme, as I mentioned before. But at the same time, one cannot ignore that despite the many practical issues that I have mentioned, that my distinguished fellow panelists have mentioned, you also have the incentives. And what are the incentives? In less than a minute, Dana, I will try. So dynamic price signals, you have green capacity auctions, you have green certificates, you have prospects for carbon pricing, such as, for example, Oman's tradable energy credit plan, or Saudi Arabia's plan on a voluntary trading platform for carbon offsets and credits in the whole MENA region. So the prospects, we can say, are there.
Thank you so much.
I was brief.
Very brief. But don't worry, because now Rafael Villaseca got the opportunity to make a summary and analysis of all you have said, all of you together. So, but before, please, I will ask you, the audience, to please join me in thanking not only the panelists, but also the interpreters that have been working for us all the morning. So thank you so much. Please.
Bueno. Muchas gracias a todos. Thank you very much. Really interesting insights about all of the MENA region. Bueno, para finalizar esta sesión, está con nosotros Rafael Villaseca, presidente de la Fundación Naturgy.
Muy buenas tardes. Es realmente una satisfacción tener la posibilidad de dirigir unas palabras en la clausura de este acto, que desde luego renuncio a que sea un resumen de lo mucho y muy bueno que se ha dicho, pero sí hacer alguna reflexión breve, dada la hora ya, sobre el tema que nos ha ocupado. La verdad es que para la Fundación Naturgy este es un tema relevante. Como es conocido, uno de nuestros objetivos fundamentales es entrar a analizar el mundo de la energía, aportando datos, aportando opiniones objetivas y fundadas que permitan que todas las personas interesadas puedan formar criterio, opinión y la toma de decisiones. La razón es que el mundo de la energía no es ninguna novedad, no lo fue nunca en la historia. Es un mundo extraordinariamente complejo y que realmente requiere de conocer sus pormenores para la toma de decisiones. Ciertamente, esto ha hecho y hace que la Fundación dedique sus esfuerzos a promover actos, papers, reuniones, seminarios sobre un montón de cuestiones, intentando arrojar esa luz sobre el sector, desde el punto de vista económico, social, desde el punto de vista regulatorio, desde el punto de vista técnico. Y ciertamente, la geopolítica no ha estado en nuestro foco hasta ahora, y no porque sea ajena al sector, no lo fue jamás. Si echamos una ojeada muy rápida, siquiera, a lo que ha sido la evolución de la energía en España, nos damos cuenta inmediatamente de la trascendencia que han tenido cuestiones geopolíticas. Ha sido, pues, y es interés en la Fundación aportar objetivos, aportar datos, aportar información y luz. Y realmente esa es una cuestión que creemos que de la que no anda sobrado el mundo de la energía para hacer frente a los enormes retos que hay. Se ha dicho, de los tres objetivos que se persiguen en cualquier política energética, y eso es tradicional ya, probablemente, o casi con seguridad, no se está cumpliendo ninguno de los tres. No estamos cumpliendo los objetivos de sostenibilidad, la energía no es barata en absoluto, ha subido, y finalmente la seguridad está en entredicho. Por lo tanto, y a pesar de enormes esfuerzos llevados a cabo por muchos países, entre ellos España, la verdad es que no hemos conseguido hasta la fecha avanzar de una manera clara y decidida en los tres objetivos que nos habíamos marcado. Ciertamente, la crisis de Ucrania trastoca las cosas, pero las trastoca porque las acelera y las agrava, no porque, en mi modesta opinión, este es mi personal disclaimer, cambien radicalmente. Las acelera y las agrava, pero las bases de los problemas que padecemos eran anteriores. Creo que los ponentes podrían estar de acuerdo con esta afirmación personal mía. Y eso es serio y es importante y requiere que reflexionemos, porque los datos, las opiniones fundadas, no resuelven el problema, pero ayudan mucho a hacerlo y realmente se hace difícil pensar que podamos resolverlo con una visión parcial del problema que nos enfrentamos. Y creo que esa es una de las cuestiones, porque si el problema de la energía es grave, la transición energética ha elevado a una potencia muy importante la gravedad o la complejidad del tema de la energía. La transición energética, imprescindible y necesaria, es extraordinariamente compleja. Y no se puede observar desde un punto de vista, o desde dos o desde tres. Son desde muchos a la vez. Y cuando no se hace, nos topamos con un montón de problemas. Por lo tanto, hay que ser enormemente conscientes de que nos enfrentamos a algo que ya se ha dicho, que no es rápido, que no es barato y que no es sencillo. Y en ocasiones quizá el problema se nos ha planteado en unos términos no exactamente realistas y naturalmente enfrentarnos con la realidad acelerada por el problema de Ucrania nos produce cuanto menos desasosiego. Yo quisiera indicar que el avanzar en este terreno es fundamental porque si bien aportar datos puede que no sea toda la solución, es necesaria, lo que sí es seguro es que plantear soluciones sin tener en cuenta los datos suele ser una receta para el fracaso. Y esa es una ocasión que deberíamos reflexionar de una manera más detallada. Bien, actualmente nos planteamos los objetivos de sostenibilidad y es absolutamente necesario tener la variedad geoestratégica. A nadie le puede sorprender, naturalmente nos sorprende la crisis de Ucrania, pero no los problemas geoestratégicos que puede y que nos han planteado en una zona como el Medio Oriente. Era lo normal. Si realmente Europa lidera y bien hace, y es un objetivo deseable, importante, urgente y grave, el cambio climático, no es menos cierto que es el 10% de la emisión que hay en el mundo y que otro 90% está fuera de su ámbito. Y que, por lo tanto, si además tiene presente que la energía primaria que consume mayoritariamente viene de fuera, será imprescindible tener en cuenta la geoestrategia para evitar fenómenos indeseables que se han de producir, puesto que los países que no están en la Unión Europea son los que proveen esa energía de la que hoy tenemos que echar mano para avanzar y además son el 90% de la emisión de los gases de efecto invernadero. Por lo tanto, tener en cuenta esto no es algo circunstancial, probablemente es junto a otros capítulos, el tecnológico, el regulatorio, etcétera, es una cuestión vital. Es por esa razón que tenía un extraordinario interés nuestra fundación en también entrar en este tema y hemos tenido la suerte de contar con el Real Instituto Elcano y con Gonzalo, a quien realmente le agradecemos muchísimo el esfuerzo, para que organizar estas jornadas, empezando por el Middle East, es decir, la cuna del problema geoestratégico en la energía, intentaremos seguir avanzando en dar datos, objetivos y opiniones fundadas de personas tan relevantes como las que hoy nos acompañan en el panel, de forma y manera que podamos ilustrar este grave problema. Y acabo ya. Solamente insistir. Se toman las decisiones mirando un objetivo final. Creo que es necesario mirar el camino que queremos para llegar a esas decisiones, a ese objetivo final. El camino no es una cuestión secundaria, es vital. Determinados caminos se ciegan rápidamente, lo hemos visto, no solo desde el punto de vista geopolítico, también social. Quien nos recuerda el problema de los Gilets Jaunes u otros que podríamos ya aflorar. Es absolutamente necesario que se tomen en cuenta la globalidad y trascendencia del problema, así como su coste y, por supuesto, el camino que vamos a escoger para llegar a él. De lo contrario, quizá dediquemos enormes esfuerzos y finalmente nos lleven a caminos no deseados y a problemas que nos ocasionan costes y un profundo desagrado y quizá desarraigo social. En fin, con esta visión, que quiere también ser optimista, porque no hay ninguna duda que la reacción de la sociedad como tal es potente, importante, y que no solo la sociedad, sino las empresas están permanentemente alineadas y con interés, creo que debemos insistir y marcarnos el objetivo de procurar avanzar por el camino de la objetividad y el rigor. En este interés modesto pero constante de nuestra fundación, les doy las gracias por su asistencia, tanto presencial como con conexión a este acto, con el compromiso de que seguiremos intentando presentar cosas similares y con el deseo de contar con la colaboración del Instituto Elcano. Y repitiendo las gracias no solo al Real Instituto, sino a todos los que han participado, me despido de ustedes y les agradezco su atención e interés. Muchas gracias.